You're listening to ฝึกฟังภาษาอังกฤษชิวๆกับเจ้าของภาษาโดยครูโรซี่สวัสดีค่ะทุกๆคนขอบคุณที่รับฟังพอดคาสต์แรกของโรซี่ในพอดคาสต์นี้โรซี่จะแนะนำตัวเองและเล่าประวัติและประสบการณ์เรียนภาษาไทยและประสบการณ์เป็นครูสอนภาษาอังกฤษที่ไทยโรซี่จะพูดช้าๆแต่ว่าถ้าคนมีข้อสงสัยคอมเมนต์มาได้เลยค่ะโอเค so hi everybody and welcome to my first podcast on Blocked It this is actually one of the first podcasts that I've ever done so in the past I have maybe been a guest on another podcast on someone else's podcast but I've never done a podcast by myselfSo this is quite exciting for me and I'm actually very excited to start doing podcasts. So let me introduce myself and tell you a little bit about my background. If you have any questions that about maybe some vocabulary or if they're questions about me or anything that you would like to ask, then please comment down below. So my name is Rosie. Everyone in England calls me Rosanna. That's my first name is Rosanna. But when I first came to Thailand, everyone found it very difficult to pronounce my name, Rosanna. So I just said, oh, my nickname is Rosie. So my name has now become Rosie. But when I go back to the UK, when I go back to see my friends and my family, in England, they do call me Rosanna.So as I mentioned, I am from England. I'm from Oxford. So I don't know whether any of you have been to England or to Oxford before, but it is a lovely city. It's a small city. It's not a big city like Bangkok. It's a small university city in the south of England, and it's about 1 hour from London.So it's a gorgeous city with a lot of history, mainly because of the university. So it has this very nice feel to it because it has a lot of students. So yeah, it's got a very, yeah, like I said, it's got a lovely feel to it. And it just makes you feel very intelligent when you're there. mainly, there are lots of intelligent people there who go to Oxford University.But myself, even though I grew up in Oxford, I didn't study at Oxford University. I studied at Leeds University. So Leeds University is in the north of England. I can't tell you exactly how far it is from Oxford, but it is a few hours by train. So in England, it's actually...normal not to study in the same town that you grew up. So like to go to Oxford University, I don't know anybody from Oxford that went to Oxford University. It's just part of kind of British culture. We'll be talking in other podcasts about British culture, but yeah, it's quite normal for British people to go to another city when they study. I studied at Leeds University and I studied Thai language. So actually the course name was Thai Language and Southeast Asian Studies. So I learned Thai language as well as studying about Southeast Asia. So that was a kind of about the...what did I study? Gosh, I'm trying to remember exactly. It was a while ago. But it was basically about the history and economics and culture. It was kind of religion as well. It was kind of a general overview of Southeast Asia. So it was, many people asked me why I chose this subject. The reason why I chose this subject was because I was interested in Asia.In general, that came from, actually I grew up with students living in my house. My mum in the past was a host mother. So a host mother, for those of you that don't know, basically mean that
the students came and stayed in our house, and then my mum was responsible for looking after them, cooking for them, cleaning. So I grew up with lots of foreign students, and many of them being Asian. So I grew up, basically being surrounded by Asian people. And I'm sure, as you all know, Asian and Eastern and Western cultures, they're quite different. But there was something about Asian and Eastern culture that really interested me. So I decided, okay, so at university, I would love to study more about Asia. And then I thought, oh, it would be wonderful if I could study a language as well. Actually at school, I wasn't very good at languages. I studied French, and I actually really, really enjoyed French, but found it very, very difficult. And I also studied German for maybe a year, and again, German was really difficult for me. So it's strange that I still have this passion and this desire to learn a new language. Anyway, then when I was applying to university, I knew I wanted to study something about Asia. I wasn't sure exactly what, and then I came across this course, Thai and Southeast Asian Studies, and I basically decided that this was the course for me. It looked really, really interesting, and interestingly, I had never been to Thailand before. So this is a thing that shocks many people, is that I studied Thai language at university before I had even ever been to Thailand. So yeah, it was quite like a big decision that I made, that it's like choosing that course obviously changed my life. But what I did know about Thailand was from what I'd seen on the internet, from what people had told me, from photos. So it wasn't like I knew nothing about the country, but I had never visited before. And with regards to the language itself, I had listened to it a little bit, and I knew that I liked the sound of Thai language. I also liked how Thai language looked. And something that was also appealing to me was the fact that there was a Thai alphabet. Obviously with Chinese language or Japanese, I think with Japanese as well, I'm not 100% sure, but you need to learn every character. Whereas obviously with Thai language is similar to English in the sense that you have an alphabet. So many people ask me like, oh, how was it learning the alphabet and things? I mean, it was very, very confusing to begin with, but that was a better option than learning characters in Chinese and sitting down and trying to memorize, oh God, like just one character. Yeah, I really admire people that learn Chinese as a new language or even Japanese. So Thai language, it was very, very new to me. So I decided, okay, this was the language that I wanted to study, and I just went for it. So it was a 4-year course. I began, as I said, learning the alphabet, starting right from the beginning. I think for me, the hardest part about learning Thai language was the sounds and the tones. I mean, I remember sitting for ages just like trying to work out like low tone, high tone, mid tone, rising tone, falling tone, and I was so confused. And I think the hardest thing was that I couldn't hear the difference. I think that this is the one thing about pronunciation, is that you need to be able to hear the sound and recognize the sound in order to be able to produce the sound yourself. So for me, I couldn't even hear the five different tones. So there was no way that I was going to be able to produce those five different sounds. So it was a real struggle at the beginning. I really did struggle. The first year was so difficult for me, trying to get my head around the alphabet, the sounds. Oh God, it was difficult. But the one thing that was easier, I should say, was the grammar. Obviously in Thai language, you don't have past tense, you don't have present, well, you obviously have well, yeah, you don't have set tenses like we do in England, English, I should say. So that was the easy part for me. And also the structure of the sentences in Thai generally are very similar to the English structure. So in general, that part was the easy part for me. And so then second year, I went to Chiang Mai. So I think for most language courses, you normally go and study abroad in your third year. But I actually studied abroad in my second year, which was it was challenging. It was really, yeah, I don't want to say difficult. I like to say challenging. It sounds better. So yeah, I went to Chiang Mai, and that was my first time in Thailand, and it was just, everything was so new to me. Yeah, I was just like, for me, I absolutely loved it. Obviously, Chiang Mai is beautiful. I loved the mountains in Chiang Mai. I loved the people. I loved the food. I used to ride around on a little motorbike, on a scooter, and it was just great. I was just loving life. But I think the hardest, obviously those things were all amazing. I think the hardest thing back then still was the language. It was still new to me. And because I'm a talkative and friendly person, I found it very difficult and challenging for me that I couldn't communicate how I wanted to. I think that the one thing that many people find difficult with learning a language is that when you learn a new language, you can't express yourself on a deep level like you can in your own language. And I think that you kind of have to speak in a way that's like a child. And I found that very, very difficult, that I wanted to express myself. I wanted to express my feelings, express my opinions, but it was very difficult not having the vocabulary. And even nowadays, I sometimes still find it challenging in Thai language to be able to express myself in a way that I would in my own language, in English. So I think that was the most challenging thing for me. But as a whole, it was a wonderful year. I absolutely loved it. And then I went back to the UK for my third and fourth year and continued. And I did actually go back to the UK and realize how much I had learnt. It was amazing. I remember my Thai teacher talking to me in Thai and me understanding her. And I thought, oh gosh, when I was in first year, I didn't understand anything, basically, she said. So yeah, that was an improvement. And then by fourth year, okay, I was getting better. I was able to obviously write about more complicated things. But I definitely was better at writing than I was speaking. So I think it's, yeah, maybe I just had more practice. I was able to read and write, but I was scared to make mistakes, just like many people are scared to make mistakes in English. So this goes on to my point about, basically coming to Thailand. I graduated and then decided, okay, I want to come to Thailand to share my knowledge of English. I want people to feel confident when speaking English. I don't want people to feel scared like I often felt. So that was what made me decide to come to Thailand. And obviously I had studied Thai language, so I thought it made sense for me to come to Thailand and use what I had learned in my degree. So I thought, okay, I'll come here for 1 year and share my knowledge and enjoy living in Thailand again. But this time I decided that I would go to Bangkok. I'd already experienced life in Chiang Mai, and even though I loved it, I felt like, okay, Bangkok, I need to try Bangkok. I also knew some people living in Bangkok at the time, so I thought Bangkok is the right place for me. I was still young. Well, I still am young, but back then I was even younger, so I wanted like a busy, exciting life. So came to Bangkok and kind of thought, okay, I'll stay for 1 year. And then 1 year became 2 years, then 2 years became 3 years. And then now I have been here for 7 years, actually over 7 years. So the time here has gone so, so quickly. It's been such a wonderful experience. But I sound like it's over. It's not over. I'm still here. I'm still enjoying every part of living here, whether it be the food, whether it be the people, the culture, the language. I mean, everything excites me about Bangkok. So I'm still here. People always ask me when or how long I will stay in Bangkok for. For me, I feel like I don't need to make a decision. Right now, I'm happy here. Right now, I enjoy working here. So I have no reason to go back anytime soon. And I do feel like Thailand is my home. But I feel like you never know what will happen. So for me, I'm very, very open to the future. I may move to Chiang Mai. I may move back to England. I really don't know. But all I know now in the present moment is that I'm happy in the near future that, yeah, I will be in Thailand and Bangkok. So yes, that's a question that many people like to ask me. But my answer is always the same, that I can't say 100% sure, because life, we never know where life will take us. And I think that's the beautiful thing about life, is that we just don't know what will happen. So, I mean, for now, I'm here and loving living here, as I said. So since I moved here 7 years ago, I've been teaching. So teaching has been such a wonderful experience for me. I mean, the reason why, as I said, I decided to become a teacher was for the reason that I wanted to help people. I wanted to help people feel confident. And I think that I do that. I like to think that I do that. It makes it's very rewarding. I think that's the main thing about teaching, is that it is a rewarding experience. And also, obviously, I meet so many different people. And yeah, it's just so lovely to be able to make people feel confident and help people enjoy learning English. I know that learning a language, it's not easy. It is challenging. I know that people really struggle, the same how I felt when I lived in Chiang Mai at times, that I couldn't communicate. I think that many people feel like that too. So I think that's something which I try to help people with. And yeah, I really enjoy doing it. So that's the best part about teaching. It's a very rewarding experience for me. And then as well as teaching, then obviously I run my Facebook page and I record videos. And I love doing those videos as well. They're always fun. It's nice to share knowledge. Often throughout the day, I'm always trying to think of like, okay, what will the next video be? What else? Or it will be something will just come to me. And I just think, oh, that's such a nice thing to teach. So for me, I don't focus too much on grammar, even though grammar is important. I mean, for me, I think that vocabulary is maybe more important. Obviously, a mixture between grammar and vocabulary. But I think the most important thing with any language is just that you use it. So I just tell people, yeah, try and find any opportunity to practice English, whether it's at home by yourself. I mean, I've had actually quite a few students who speak English very well, and I've asked them, so how have you practiced English? I said, they tell me they haven't studied abroad, but they speak English with nice pronunciation, they speak clearly. And I asked them, how did you learn English? And they say, oh, I practiced at home by talking to myself. And I just love this. I just think it's so wonderful that people actually talk out loud. So I think that with learning any language, it's about finding any way to practice English, whether it's watching a movie, whether it's talking to yourself at home, whether it's listening to podcasts, whether it's watching movies or clips on YouTube or whatever. Basically, I think with any language, it's about just doing a little bit every day and involving yourself with the language. I think one of my last points that I would just like to add also is that with learning a language, it's also about connecting with the culture. And I know that for some people, if you're not in a country, it's maybe harder to connect with the culture. But for me, the culture is such a big part of it. And if you understand the culture, it will help you to understand the language. For me, language and culture are so interconnected. So this is something also which I like to emphasize to my students and to anybody learning English or a foreign language, that you need to connect with the culture, and then the language will come naturally. I don't know whether any of you listeners, whether you agree or not, but that's how I feel. So I think that's going to be my last point for today. I actually thought this was going to be much shorter, and it's turned into 20 minute long podcast for my first one, but that's a kind of brief introduction to my background and my teaching and my learning of Thai language and my life in Thailand. So if you've enjoyed this podcast, then please like, please comment, and please share the podcast. I think that sharing it is so important to allow others to hear it. And yeah, I'm new to this app, so it would be great if you could share it to invite other people to be part of my page and part of my Learning English community. So thank you so much for listening, and I will be doing an episode 2 very, very soon. So have a lovely day and enjoy the lovely weather in Thailand, because it is just wonderful at the moment. Okay, bye everybody. Bye-bye.